And thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm going to talk about, yes, a little bit, sensorimotor approach, the role of the body in the brain when we are watching performing arts, and in fact, not really performing arts in general, but I'm going to focus on dance. So I guess the first question would be for you, how many people in the audience consider themselves professional dancers? How many people consider they dance regularly, so they are not professional dancers, but they enjoy dancing and they go to dance? Fantastic. How many people in the audience haven't danced in their life in a class? Or David, have you been in a dancing class? Okay, so the rest of people with experience of dance, they outgrow us in number to the people without experience in that. Very good. That's normally not the case in the kind of audience I talk to. During the talk, I would like to show you a few examples of how cognitive neuroscientists like myself, how we try to understand how the brain, the human brain, process dance when we are watching dance. And then I'll give you a few examples of what happens when we see dance. How does the brain process dance that we like? And then I'll talk about something else. After working a few years with dancers, we came to the conclusion that dancers, actually, they have quite of a special brain, so they are special. And now we've been trying to understand if they are special in the way they process dance, so their expertise, the motor expertise they have acquired, changed the way they process dance. Is it only the way they process dance, or they are just special and their motor expertise affect the way they see the world, basically? So we are going to see that as well. The first slide basically focuses on how does the brain process dance, and it uses a very basic paradigm that explains how the brain processes any other movement. So if we have somebody like myself without any dance experience watching a dance, we can have this video or the fantastic video that Luisa just put before. The mirror neuron theory that has been defined in neuroscience now 30 years ago, suggests that when we observe an action, we are internally simulating that same action in our head. So my internal simulation will be quite rough because that's my level. But if we have a different kind of observer, let's say we have Carlos Acosta and Tamara Rojo observing this piece of dance, their way they internally simulate the dance they are watching will be much more accurate, okay? There will be a more detailed and more fine representation, internal representation of this dance. This is basically the hypothesis that we had many years ago already, 2005, really 15 years ago. And this is what we tested. So I was in London working with Patrick Haggard. And what we did in a study is that we look at, we took a series of that's very ahead. We took a series of videos of dance, classical ballet, and we also had another expert doing movements of capoeira, and we have a choreographer with us, Tom Safford, that helped us match in the kinematics of both of them. So we have kind of similar amount of arms and legs movement, an amount of displacement of the space, and if the movement was vertical or horizontal. So we had this from ballet and dance movements, and we got a group of ballet dancers from the Royal Opera House in London and a group of capoeira dancers, practitioners also from the school in London, and we put them in the scanner to watch these videos. So both groups watch videos of dance and video of classical ballet and videos of capoeira. And we were interested in seeing if your brain responds differently when you see the action that you know compared to the action that you don't know. And this is basically what happened. So the areas with the arrow are areas in what has been called action observation system. So there are regions that hold a motor representation of our own body, and they seem to respond more strongly when you watch the action that you know. So when the ballet dancers so this is here, when the ballet dancers watch ballet, and when the capoeira dancers watch capoeira, these areas that represent a motor simulation respond more strongly than when they watch the other dance style. Interestingly, we also had a group of non-dancers that at that time were mainly psychology students without dance experience, and their brain respond in a very similar way. The amount, the intensity of the activation in the sensory motor areas was very similar for the observation of ballet or capoeira. So my brain doesn't make a big difference between watching a man's, you know, someone doing ballet or capoeira. So this was the first study, and as I said, it's kind of quite a few years ago. And after working with dancers, we thought that we needed to understand also what happened when we see dance that we like. So then, for a second, I thought it was my phone. So then what we did is we forgot about the classification ballet capoeira, and we asked people how much they liked every individual video. So we put them the videos again, and we asked them to rate them in a scale between 1 and 7, and then we compare those videos that people prefer with those people that people prefer less. And this is what we got. So this was the first paper that was on the sensorimotor aesthetics of performing art. And basically what suggested is that when people is watching videos that they liked, there is a stronger activation in this particular area of the brain that is the premotor cortex, so very similar area to the one we had before. And this area responds less when we see videos that we like less. So just to make you a summary, basically, we have liking and we have an internal sensory motor response. And it seems that the more we like a video, the more we like a movement, the stronger is the sensory motor response in our brain. Or it can be the other way around. It can be the stronger the sensory motor response, the more I like the video. So with these kind of studies, we are unable to tell what comes first. Do I like a movement because my sensory motor brain is resonating? Or do I resonate because I really like the movement? So we are not yet able to answer this question, but I think will be something quite interesting to do. So that was the first study about aesthetics, and there were a few others, but I wanted to talk a little bit about the expertise. So working a lot with dancers, we thought, okay, internally there is a representation of the observed movement, and the question is like, is this internal representation useful for something? And if you think about, you can think about dance or you can think about sport. When you look at the Olympics, for example, figure skating, you see a fantastic performance. And at the very end, the judge always say, that was a lovely performance, but there was a problem in the second jump because the knee was a little bit bent. I didn't see that. But the experts, they saw that. So we were under the impression that people with a motor expertise, they are also able to see more in the movement, okay? So that's what we wanted to test if they actually have a stronger, a higher visual sensitivity, if they can see more details. And I put you an example of how we did that. We tried to make the stimuli a bit more difficult. So we did a few studies where we disentangled the dancer of the body from the movement itself to see if we are experts on the body or we are experts on the dynamic. We are probably experts on everything. And the idea is like, if you are a very good ballet dancer, you do a movement, and if you are a bailarina, also very good bailarina, if you do the same movement that your friend, your movement will be quite similar. So most bailarinas in a group performing synchrony movements, they will do it in a very similar way. But if I take the bailarina away and I only leave the movement, I get something like that. So what we did, so everybody will be able to recognize what movement is that. And what we did is having videos of these, that is a technique called point light display, of only the kinematic of many bailarinas doing the same movement and putting pairs of videos and asking participants if they are able to discriminate, is this the same ballerina or is a different one? So it's a really very difficult task that dancers can do actually quite well. So this is just, let me summarize this figure. This is the level of the performance. So the taller the bar, better performance, better they can do this task. Male dancers and female dancers, they can do this task quite well. They are able to distinguish one ballerina from the other. While male and females non-dancers, they are at chance level, they are unable to do this task. So having the motor expertise, the experience, allow you to see more details in the movement. Okay. So we have some difference at the neural level, some difference at the behavioral level, and we wanted to find something else. So if your brain responds differently, if you can see more, is this useful in any case? And we thought that dance, a lot of the dance, what it does is that it transmits emotion. So emotion is a very important component in dance and in art as well. But I think it's actually quite difficult to investigate. In other art forms, for example, paintings or sculpture, it's very easy to understand the emotion that is being represented here. So if I ask you to choose, do you think this is kind of a happy or a sad image? I guess there will be around 100% agreement on what it is, and kind of something similar along here. So if you think about different kinds of observers, people like myself, I'm able to understand the emotion represented in this artwork. People with experience in art, dancers, they will be also able to recognize the emotion here. But if I put a video of dance and I ask you to tell me which emotion is being represented, I don't see that easy. You are many dancers in the room, so maybe most of you can tell, but will you be able to tell the top one here if it is more of a happy movement or a sad movement? And what about the one below here? How many of you will think that this is a positive, representing a positive emotion? How many of you think that will be a negative emotion? The dancers. What about the one on top? Positive emotion? Negative emotion? It's definitely not 100% agreement like we had with the previous artwork. So we thought we are going to test this as well. So we are going to test it at the behavioral level. So we are going to measure just by asking participants to rate. And this is some work that we did with Julia. Julia spent a few years in London before she came back to Germany. And I didn't say that before, but these videos are the videos of a normalized library that Julia has created. So when we are doing experimental work with dance, it's very important to have the right kind of stimuli. So if you are thinking of doing experimental work with dance, don't just pick any random videos in the internet, just look for stimuli that are normalized and you know what they represent. But let me show you the study, or a brief version of the study. My hypothesis is that dancers with experience, they will be able to discriminate the emotion, and people like myself will see, right? And what we did here, not only we look at behavioral responses, but we also look at physiological responses. So while people were watching these dance videos, we attached a couple of electrodes to the tips of the finger to measure the galvanic skin response. So this is a measurement of your arousal level. And normally it's used in emotional studies, so it should be able to differentiate the understanding that you have of positive or negative emotions. And what we found is that both groups are able to distinguish the emotion at the behavioral level, but at the physiological level, the controls they are not sensitive. So the galvanic response doesn't show any difference when they see videos that they think is happy or videos that they think they are unhappy or sad. However, the dancers saw a difference at this physiology level between seeing videos or dance movements that they consider happy and videos that they consider sad. So that kind of make the dancers not only better at seeing details in the movement, but also they become kind of very emotional sensitive. It's not about recognizing the emotion, it's about feeling the emotion. So you feel more. What we thought it was a very interesting approach, how you come from a motor expertise, how your motor training allow you also to have this kind of not only motor sensitivity, but emotional sensitivity. And the question that we are asking now, and I don't have a lot of data to show you, but I just want to throw you the idea that we are looking into, is if this emotional sensitivity is exclusive for when they are watching dance, because they know it, or if it is a generalized response that can apply to other kind of stimuli. So they are always more emotionally sensitive. And the way of studying that, I guess there are many ways, but the way we thought of studying that is by using emotional stimuli who we are all familiar with. For example, faces. So if I show you an angry face or a happy face, I guess both dancers and non-dancers will have a high level of agreement in what is the expression represented in the faces. So we are all experts with faces, right? So what we did is that we got dancers and non-dancers watching faces of different people showing different kinds of emotions. And we look at the brain response, the brain activity. And this time we measure that with electroencephalography. So we could see the timing of this early response. And this is just a very screenshot that we have of some very early data. We are still working on this. But what we are starting to find is that at a very visual level, when we are processing these faces, we have a difference on very early processing between 100 and 150 milliseconds. So I'm talking about really early processing that is different between dancers and non-dancers when they are watching emotional faces. So this suggests that that kind of emotional sensitivity they have, that motor expertise, it's modulated not only how they see dance, but many other stimuli, how they perceive, in this case, faces. But I'm sure that if we will do more studies with other kind of stimuli, we will see that it's a generalized response. So this is just a final slide to conclude. Yes, I've been talking a little bit about an action observation mechanism that represent an internal motor simulation of your action that seems to be more active if I know the action I'm watching. It also seems to be sensitive to the level of liking. Also, it seems that this motor expertise or this stronger sensory motor response allowed you to see more fine details in the movement itself and allow you to understand or get more information, not only of the movement, but what the movement might represent, in this case, in emotional content. And it's not only about dance, but me also about faces and about many other stimuli that they still need to be tested. So I leave it here. I would like to show you that all the research that we do is basically supported by many collaborators and many PhD students and postdocs that they are working. Special mention to Vasiliki Miletaki, who has been doing a lot of the work of recollecting dancers around London. That is not an easy task, even if there are many. And they are happy to come to the lab and get the brains scanned. And Julia was with us a couple of years ago, but she left. And before you go, if you are interested in experimental aesthetics, we will be holding in London in September, in a few months, a conference from the International Association of Empirical Aesthetics from the 1st to the 4th of September. This is a conference that happens every 2 years, and we have already confirmed a couple of speakers. There will be more keynote speakers. And we try to combine experimental aesthetics with people from the art world, artists, how aesthetics is included in education and in well-being. So have a look at our website. It's organized together with Guido Oaks and Rebecca Chamberlain. So hopefully I get some interest from some of you and I see you again explaining your own work. Thanks. Thank you.